Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Flying Grunt, the story of Lieutenant General Richard E. Carey, United States Marine Corps retired, by Alan E. Mesches, narrated by Chris Monteiro. Preface. Up from the enlisted ranks, Marine Second Lieutenant Richard Edward Carey led platoons and served as intelligence officer in Korea. After participating in the Inchon landing in September 1950, Carey led his troops to Seoul. 2 months later, as an intelligence officer, Carey learned where Chinese Communist Forces, CCF, were about to attack on the Hagaru-ri perimeter in North Korea. Outnumbered 8-1, enduring sub-zero weather and blinding snow, at East Hill near the Chosin Reservoir, Carey hurled grenades at the Chinese. Holding East Hill aided the Marines as they broke through the Chinese trap and moved to the port at Hungnam. On March 23, 1951, a badly wounded Carey refused treatment at an aid station. "I have a job to do," he said. Despite mortar wounds, Carey continued leading his troops. It was his seventh near-death experience in 189 days. Finally, Carey's commander ordered him to an aid station. While his actions earned Carey a Silver Star, the wounds ended his time in Korea. Always wanting to fly, Carey won a slot in Marine Corps aviation and earned his wings as a fighter pilot. In 1967, Carey again faced Communist forces. In Vietnam, he flew 204 sorties, mostly as an F-4 fighter pilot. Carey earned the Distinguished Flying Cross and 16 air medals during the Vietnam War. Believing that his career had stalled as a lieutenant colonel in 1970, Carey looked at retirement. An opportunity to earn his college degree relaunched Carey's career. Over the next 9 years, Carey earned 4 promotions and rose to 3-star general. Carey led the evacuation of some 100,000 South Vietnamese out of Saigon to the United States. Carey completed his 38-year military career as commanding general at Quantico, Virginia. He continued serving in retirement as a member of an Ohio governor's cabinet and led the effort to build monuments honoring those who served at the Chosin Reservoir. Many would call Lieutenant General Richard E. Carey, USMC, retired, a warrior. That is fact. This book will cover both the warrior and the human sides of General Carey. 100 hours of face-to-face meetings with the general, Carey's papers, speech copies, oral histories, Marine Corps documents, and interviews with fellow Marines and family members, along with newspaper stories, went into the research for this book. The general answered tough and deeply personal questions. No subject was off limits. The general wanted the book to be right. I hope that I met his standard. Chapter 1. The Early Years. According to the general, his family had a long history of military service. The Careys descended from Irish immigrants who arrived in Massachusetts in the early 1700s. Eventually, they migrated to the Ohio Territory prior to statehood. The general's ancestors included 2 Union soldiers who served in Ohio units during the American Civil War. One died at Shiloh, Tennessee, and the other died at Chickamauga, a campaign fought in Tennessee and Georgia. A member of the Carey family served in the Spanish-American War. The general's father, Timothy Francis Carey, served in France during World War I. Many of his cousins served in World War II. The general's father entered service in July 1917 from his home in Ironton, Ohio, located along the Ohio River in the southeastern part of the state. A troop ship took him to France, where he served in Saint-Mihiel and Meuse-Argonne, earning promotions to the rank of corporal. Like so many doughboys, Timothy Carey was a mustard gas victim from his World War I service in France. The mustard gas disabled Timothy Francis Carey. The effects of mustard gas ended his career as a teacher and prevented him from rejoining the Army during World War II. Limited employment opportunities, combined with the economic tumult of the Great Depression, hampered his opportunities to earn a living. He married Marie Schlosser in 1922 when she was 18 and he was 26, according to the 1930 U.S. Census. The couple's daughter, Rosalie, was born in 1923. 5 years later, on January 10, 1928, the future general entered the world in Columbus, Ohio. Although Timothy Carey tried a couple of business ventures as a contractor and running a painting business, he ended up with little money and often had his family living in rooming houses. Pride prevented him from seeking help. They struggled on until, when Rosalie was 14 and Richard 9, Marie walked out on the family. His childhood environment helped create a value system for young Richard, who would grow up to become a highly decorated 3-star Marine Corps general. For 2 years, Richard Carey lived on his maternal grandparents' 300-acre farm in Grove City, Ohio, milking cows and undertaking other farm chores. During summers, he carried water jugs for the farm workers while riding a pony. During one stretch, Timothy Carey and his children lived with Carey's paternal grandfather, John Carey, in Columbus. Carey described his father as very intelligent and very caring, adding that, "He took care of me." He said he would have wanted his father in his platoon. Carey's father did not remarry, but his mother did. Carey did not see Marie again until he joined the Marine Corps. Carey's mother and second husband lived in the Cleveland area. With her second husband, Robert Dietrich, Marie had 2 sons, twins, and 4 daughters. Dietrich, who worked for Coca-Cola, gave 12-year-old Richard an opportunity to earn money at Ohio State football games in Columbus, picking up Coca-Cola bottles during the games. During the years following the Carey's divorce, Rosalie stayed in touch with her mother. In the decades that followed, all of Marie Schlosser Carey Dietrich's children connected with the general after his return from the Korean War. He said that he wanted to see his mother and began communicating with his siblings. Eventually, one of his half-brothers, Gerald, nicknamed Blackie because of his wavy black hair, and 17 years the general's junior, served in the Marine Corps for 4 years, including a tour of duty in Vietnam. "Now we're very close. There's no half-brother or half-sister," said General Carey. In 2021, the general's sister Bev flew from her home in Florida to spend 2 weeks with the general in Texas. She calls him every day to check on him. General Carey said that his brothers and sisters respected him. Early indicators of General Carey's resolve were evident when he started attending high school. Determining that West High School offered the best opportunity for him, Carey walked a round trip of 10 miles a day until the spring term of his sophomore year of high school when his father moved the family to within 2 miles of the school. Due to his participation in varsity sports, along with other extracurricular activities, Carey seldom came home during daylight. He became both a good student and an athlete. At West High, he won the respect of peers when he earned leadership roles as the team captain in 3 sports. During his junior year, Carey captained both the wrestling and track teams. In addition, he played halfback on the football team as a sophomore. His running ability caught the attention of the cross-country coach, and he became a distance runner on that team, captaining it as a sophomore. He won both track and cross-country events at the city and district levels, and also participated in state meets. His best event was the half mile. "I always loved to run," he said. For 2 years, Carey took part in the Spanish club and earned membership into the W Association for the school's varsity athletes who earned their letter. While in high school, he developed his strong Christian faith. He served as president of High Y at West High, an affiliate of the YMCA. Carey also was president of the Columbus-wide High Y. Participation in the wrestling team would have long-term implications for Carey. He wrestled as a 165-pound middleweight. In one meet, West High did not have heavyweight. Rather than have the heavyweight match end in a forfeit, Carey stepped up and volunteered to wrestle the opposing school's heavyweight wrestler. While he battled his much heavier rival, Carey lost the match after his opponent put him in a body lock. He was hurt, but did not know at the time how badly he was injured. After the match, Carey went to his girlfriend's house. When leaving to go home, he passed out from what he later learned was internal bleeding and ended up in the hospital. The young athlete later returned to a track meet, anchored the mile relay that his team won, and then became sick again. Doctors determined that he had suffered a ruptured kidney. Surgeons who met with Carey and his father recommended an operation to remove the damaged organ. The doctor told him, "Well, your chances are, you know, pretty good, but I can't really say that you're going to completely heal because it's pretty badly torn." Demonstrating both his resolve and stubbornness, the 16-year-old refused to let the doctors operate. Carey firmly believed that he would heal and would not give up his kidney. He also acknowledged that he was headstrong at that point in his life. Because of the damaged kidney, he recuperated at home. Unable to attend classes at West High School, Carey homeschooled himself during his senior year by getting his assignments and books brought to him. Not only did he complete his final year of high school at home, but Carey also earned membership in the National Honor Society. Requirements for National Honor Society membership included scholarship, leadership, service, and character. Those traits stayed with Carey at each juncture of his life. General Carey told on himself when he said that he originally tried to enlist in the Marine Corps in 1944. At age 16, the recruiter told him that he was too young to enlist without parental permission. That day, he was late getting home. When asked why he was uncharacteristically late, young Carey admitted that he attempted to enlist in the Marine Corps. Smiling, when he shared the story 77 years later, General Carey acknowledged that his 21-year-old sister was very upset with her brother about that. Rosalie had the dual role of big sister and surrogate mother. The general also described the Marine who declined to let him sign up for the Marine Corps as an honest recruiter. In June 1945, Carey and his fellow West High seniors received their diplomas at their graduation ceremony. While the war in Europe had ended with Germany's surrender on May 7th, Japan continued the fight in the Pacific. Many American soldiers serving in the European Theater of Operations, ETO, boarded troop ships that took them across the Atlantic, through the Panama Canal, into the Pacific. They headed for Japan during the summer. In July, just a few weeks after graduating from West High, 17-year-old Richard Carey entered military service. That began a 38-year career that would take him around the globe as he rose from a raw recruit to Lieutenant General in the United States Marine Corps, USMC. Carey explained that he might have enlisted sooner, but he and Rosalie needed to arrange care for their ailing father. The young enlistee knew that he wanted to be a pilot, so he signed up for the Navy's V-5 program, which offered recruits 2 years of training and a path toward becoming a military pilot. The Navy planned to conduct Carey's training at the University of Cincinnati, one of many college campuses hosting military instruction during World War II. More than 60,000 Navy pilots earned their wings between 1942 and 1945. However, with the end of World War II came the close of the V-5 training. The Navy did not need any more flyers. Carey declined what he termed the Navy's strong push for him to enter their officer candidate school at Ohio State University, located in his hometown of Columbus. He accepted a discharge and for 2 months drove a truck for retail merchants' delivery in Columbus during the busy holiday season. Carey still felt obligated to the country. He wanted to serve and earn the GI Bill college funding program. He also had a long-term goal of becoming a medical doctor. He recruited 4 friends to join him, and with his buddies, went to the Marine Corps recruiting station in Columbus. They all got through the verbal test, then Carey learned that all of the slots were full. Not deterred from joining the Marines, he took a train to Indianapolis where there were still slots. 3 of his 4 friends went to boot camp for basic training at the Marine Corps Training Depot at Parris Island, South Carolina. His friends started their training 2 days before Carey's arrival, and he did not see them while at Parris Island. Since 1915, Marine recruits have gone through boot camp at Parris Island. When asked how he did at boot camp, the future general quietly but proudly said, "I aced boot camp." He expressed pride in the fact that Marine Corps boot camp is at least 3 weeks longer than the Army's initial training. Despite the South Carolina heat and humidity, Carey said that he was in superb physical shape. Prior to entering the service, his preparation for track, cross-country, wrestling, and football, combined with his 4 to 10 mile round trips to school, contributed to his physical condition. He earned the slot of platoon guide during the 13 weeks of training in the summer of 1946. Selected by the drill instructor, D.I., Sergeant Kozak, the platoon guide served as the go-between with the D.I. and the platoon. The platoon guide also carried the unit guidon, or flag. Boot camp, especially his D.I., left a lifelong impression on the future Lieutenant General instructor. He shared this memory of his D.I. "The Marine Corps teaches leadership. I mean, I remember in boot camp our D.I. pounded on that. I remember that. Old Kozak, Sergeant Kozak. If he walked in the room today, I would stand at attention." Carey's initial encounters with the Navy and Marine Corps demonstrated that his superiors saw leadership skills in a young man then only a few months past his 18th birthday. After 13 weeks in the Marine Corps at boot camp, leadership became part of the young private's core values. Leadership would carry him throughout his career. Overview of the Marine Corps. As a young man, Richard E. Carey entered a small and unique service with a rich history and tradition. Marines consider themselves the best. The Marine Corps continues to have an air, land, and sea component. These words from the Marine Corps hymn describe the members of the Corps. "We fight our country's battles, in the air, on land, and sea, first to fight for right and freedom." After nearly 250 years of service, the Marine Corps remains the military's smallest service branch. There is no Marine Corps Academy. Graduates of the United States Naval Academy may choose to become officers in the Marine Corps. Awards and medals presented to Marines reference the Navy. The Marines' recruiting advertisements play on their smaller size as a unique selling proposition for candidates with this slogan, "Marines, the few, the proud." All Marine officers are riflemen, not career specialists. Officers who come from Officer Candidate School, Reserve Officer Training Corps programs, or the United States Naval Academy receive training on a wide range of military specialties at MCB Quantico, Virginia. Newly commissioned officers continue training through a lengthy program known as the Basic School, TBS. The Marine Corps became part of the U.S. military on November 10, 1775, some 7 months before the United States Declaration of Independence on July 4, 1776. Since then, Marines have answered the call in every conflict that faced their country. They have fought pirates along the Barbary Coast and battled to the halls of Montezuma in Mexico. In the American Civil War, fought between 1861 and 1865, Union forces included Marines who fought at the Battle of Bull Run in Virginia. Other Marine units served with the Navy. Before World War I, Marines served in the Spanish-American War, Philippine Insurrection, and the Boxer Rebellion in China. 9 years after the Wright brothers' first flight in 1903 at Kitty Hawk, North Carolina, about 190 miles from MCB Camp Lejeune, Marines added aviation to their mission in 1912. In World War I, Marine aviators flew bombing runs over Belgium and France. On the ground in France during World War I, the 4th Marine Brigade, known as Devil Dogs, fought in battles at Belleau Wood, Soissons, Saint-Mihiel, Blancmont, and Meuse-Argonne. Battles across islands in the Pacific brought victory to the United States in World War II and more recognition to the Marine Corps. Marines fought and died on Guadalcanal, Bougainville, Tarawa, New Britain, Saipan, Guam, Peleliu, Okinawa, and Iwo Jima. The famed photograph of Marines raising the American flag over Mount Suribachi on Iwo Jima captured the hearts and minds of Americans. In Ohio, young Richard Carey learned that older brothers of his friends served on Iwo Jima. "They were my heroes," he said in 2021. During the second half of the 20th century, Marines served in Korea and Vietnam. In the Korean War, Marines, including Second Lieutenant Richard E. Carey, landed at Inchon on September 15, 1950, drove to take Seoul, and heroically battled sub-zero temperatures along with hordes of CCF soldiers at the Chosin Reservoir. In Vietnam, after withdrawal of troops in 1973, Marines guarded U.S. assets, including the embassy in Saigon. Then Brigadier General Richard E. Carey led the evacuation of Vietnamese refugees and embassy staff in 1975. The last four military deaths connected to the war in Vietnam were Marines. In 1983, a terrorist truck bombing in Lebanon killed 241 service members, including 220 Marines, 18 sailors, and 3 soldiers. The attack hit their barracks. Following the 9/11 attacks in 2001, Marines served in Iraq and Afghanistan. During the August 2021 evacuation of Americans and Afghanistan supporters of the United States, 13 servicemen and women died. 11 of the 13 were members of the Marine Corps. 3 core values drive the Marine Corps: honor, courage, and commitment. For a Marine, honor means honor guides Marines to exemplify the ultimate in ethical and moral behavior. Never lie, never cheat or steal. Abide by an uncompromising code of integrity. Respect human dignity and respect others. Honor compels Marines to act responsibly, to fulfill our obligations, and to hold ourselves and others accountable for every action. Courage is the mental, moral, and physical strength ingrained in Marines. It carries us through the challenges of combat and aids in overcoming fear. The inner strength enables us to do what is right, to adhere to a higher standard of personal conduct, and to make tough decisions under stress and pressure. Commitment is the spirit of determination and dedication found in Marines. It leads to the highest order of discipline for individuals and units. The ingredient enables constant dedication to Corps and country. It inspires the unrelenting determination to achieve victory in every endeavor. All Marines live by the Latin phrase, Semper Fidelis. That translates into the words, always faithful. Marines shorten the phrase to Semper Fi. Those words end meetings and conversations. Written response includes SF. A higher percentage of total Marines lost their lives in World War I, World War II, the Korean War, and the Vietnam War than the Army, Navy, and the Air Force. In Vietnam, for example, the Marines accounted for 25% of total deaths, although they made up just 9% of the total U.S. force. Marines have not always been respected within the military. The Marine Corps comes under the Secretary of the Navy. No Marine held a 4-star rank until World War II. Even President Harry S. Truman showed a lack of respect for the Marine Corps. On August 29, 1950, President Truman received a letter from California Republican Congressman Gordon L. McDonough urging him to place a Marine on the Joint Chiefs of Staff. President Truman responded with an attack on the Marine Corps. In his reply to Congressman McDonough, the president said, "For your information, the Marine Corps is the Navy's police force, and as long as I am president, that is what it will remain. They have a propaganda machine that is about equal to Stalin's." The following week, President Truman issued a written apology and addressed the Marine Corps League's September 6th national meeting in Washington, D.C. As he introduced the president to the Marine Corps League, General Clifford B. Cates, commandant, said, "We in the Marine Corps appreciate courage, especially personal courage." President Truman told the audience, "When I make a mistake, I try to correct it." Sea Marine. From Paris Island, Carey's next assignment took him to San Diego, California, for Marine Sea School, where he became a seagoing Marine. On board ship, the Sea Marines Detachment, according to Carey, provided discipline of the Navy. Sea Marines ran the brig that served as the ship's jail. Carey's first post-training orders put him on the USS Boxer, an aircraft carrier that deployed out of the Bay Area in Oakland, California. On board the ship, Private Carey ran the brig, served as company clerk since he knew how to type, helped run the ship's store, and was the orderly for the ship's captain and admiral. The Boxer was a command ship with a fleet admiral on board. The captain commands the ship, with or without senior officers aboard. An orderly served in the role of an assistant. Carey stood watch outside the admiral and captain's quarters in case they needed anything. He also accompanied the captain when he attended events on shore. Carey's responsibilities as the company clerk included personnel assignments, administration, and payroll. He also was responsible for clothing, equipping, and feeding 100 men. In addition, Carey captained the gun top, where he led 12 men in preparation for air defense combat. In 1947, according to the general's papers, he passed the corporal's exam with a score of 99%. No wonder the general saved that test paper. While serving on the Boxer, Carey won the ship's middleweight boxing championship. He had learned to box at a YMCA in Columbus where he often worked out while in high school. His YMCA coach told him that he could be a boxer. Commissioned in 1945, the Boxer served on what naval historians called normal peacetime duty in the Pacific while Carey's detachment was on the ship. The young Marine's brief time in the Navy's V-5 program had convinced him that he wanted to fly. While on the Boxer, the future Marine aviator saw aircrew members up close, which only solidified that desire. By 1948, the one-time three-sport high school captain who became platoon guide in boot camp had moved quickly through the ranks. Shortly after he reached his 20th birthday, Carey had already advanced from private to sergeant in only 2 years. Carey's leadership skills drew the notice of his detachment first sergeant, James Gillis, as well as his commander, Major Warren Morris. First Sergeant Gillis taught Carey to never forget my origin from the enlisted ranks or dedication to my troops. He also thought enough of Carey to trust him as a babysitter for his 8-year-old son, Jim. The younger Gillis would go on to join the Marine Corps, make the service a career, and retire as a full colonel. Major Morris told then-Sergeant Carey, "You ought to be an officer." That conversation took place shortly after an eventful evening when Carey accompanied the ship's captain, Stanhope C. Ring, when he went ashore in a gig. The gig, known as the captain's taxi, was a smaller craft that took the captain, a naval captain equals the rank of a Marine full colonel, from the ship to shore. As the pair returned to the Boxer in the evening, the gig struck a sandbar. Corporal Carey called an enlisted sailor on board who helped him work the gig around the sandbar to get the captain back on the ship. The captain told Major Morris that Carey was a good Marine, a leader. Initially, the young sergeant declined Morris's offer, telling the major about his plan to go to college and then become a doctor. The major persisted. The conversation lasted about an hour, and Carey finally relented. Morris wrote a letter of recommendation that gained Carey entry into what he called a program for a special type of Marine. After getting the recommendation of Major Morris, Carey agreed to apply to Officer Candidate School, OCS. He took and passed several tests. Within a month, he headed from California to Quantico, Virginia, about 35 miles south of Washington, D.C. Quantico covers more than 55,000 acres and is one of the Marine Corps' largest installations. Just before his OCS class began, Carey suffered an attack of appendicitis. He underwent surgery in the base hospital and spent 3 days recuperating there. By the time he had recovered, the OCS class was already underway. In Carey's case, school leaders decided that this special type of Marine could skip the 90-day training based on his record and experience. Over the next 3 months, Carey served on guard duty and worked on special projects. He then joined the class for a challenging 9-month training program known as the Basic School, TBS, as a second lieutenant. All newly commissioned Marine lieutenants went through the TBS program, exposing them to everything in the Marine Corps. There were more than 300 lieutenants in that TBS class. The group included graduates from the Naval Academy, Reserve Officer Training Corps, ROTC, colleges, and former enlisted Marines. Overall, the one-time sergeant who never attended college finished 7th in that class, placing 2nd in leadership and 15th in academics. According to General Carey, approximately 100 members of his original TBS class members dropped from the program. "The basic school was a very important part of my development," he said. At 21, on April 13, 1949, Richard Edward Carey earned the gold bars of a Marine Corps second lieutenant with a date of rank of June 4, 1948. He would eventually earn 8 more promotions. In 1949, after he completed TBS, Lieutenant Carey received his first assignment as an officer. His orders directed him to report to 1st Battalion, 4th Marines, known as 1-4, at Camp Lejeune, North Carolina. Opened in 1941 near the beaches between Wilmington and Morehead City, the setting provided a perfect location for amphibious training. The camp was named in honor of a past Marine Corps commandant, Lieutenant General John A. Lejeune. The historic mission of the camp that continues today is to maintain combat-ready units for expeditionary deployment. Chapter 2. On to Korea. 5 years after the end of World War II, American service members entered a new conflict, facing a new enemy, communist forces. During World War II, allies of the United States included China and the Soviet Union. In the Korean War, the United States faced their former allies as the enemy. North Korea received military hardware from the Soviets, while the Chinese crossed into North Korea with hundreds of thousands of soldiers. In 1945, combined totals of the armed forces of the United States stood at just over 12 million. With the end of the war, the numbers rapidly declined, and by 1950, the number of active-duty military members had dropped to just under 1.5 million. To boost troop strength with the advent of the Korean War, the military called up the reserves and utilized the draft. Neither were popular options. By 1952, the number of Americans serving in uniform topped 3.6 million. Only World War II had seen more people serving in the military. The 1952 Korean War total military strength surpassed the number who served in World War I by 738,000 and the peak number in Vietnam by nearly 90,000. On June 25, 1950, Lieutenant Carey was planning his future outside of the Marine Corps. Newly returned to Camp Lejeune after a tour in the Mediterranean, he looked forward to finally going to college. 1-4 had reconstituted as 1st Battalion 6th Marines, 1-6. Carey became platoon leader of 1st Platoon Alpha Company, 1st Battalion 6th Marines, and served with a battalion landing team as part of an amphibious task force deployed to the Mediterranean between 1949 and 1950. In that role, the lieutenant led special operations and once commanded 150 Marines. His two-year active-duty commitment was ending. The young officer was filling out paperwork with two objectives: go to college and spend 4 years in the Marine Corps Reserve, when a friend told him that North Korea had just crossed the 38th parallel into South Korea. The comment from his friend not only changed Carey's short-term plan, but also affected the next 33 years of his life. "I tore up my papers right there." When asked why he made the life-altering decision, the general simply said, "I am a Marine." Shortly after deciding to remain on active duty, Lieutenant Carey assisted with a court-martial, the military justice system for trials, at Camp Lejeune. His involvement with the court-martial ended with a call to the battalion headquarters, where he received orders to take 1st Platoon Alpha Company 6th Marines via train with the 2nd Division's equipment to the 1st Marine Division, 1st MARDIV, in California. That equipment eventually went to Korea. Carey received $3,000 in cash to purchase food for his troops. As the train did not offer meal service, Lieutenant Carey went to the caboose one stop in advance of each mealtime to send ahead orders for 50 meals. The food came from Harvey House, a food service company that sold food along railroad stops. Carey placed meal orders 3 times a day for 7 days as the train wound across the country. General Carey recalled going north from Camp Lejeune into Kentucky. Then the train went to St. Louis and headed west to California. Along with the caboose, he said the train had freight cars that carried the Marines' equipment and a Pullman section used by his troops. During July 1950, Carey was at MCB Camp Pendleton, California, for training prior to joining the fight in Korea. The Marines trained 18 hours a day in the foothills of Santa Margarita Mountains. Carey described it as good training for Korea. "There was a lot of emphasis on physical training," he said. "That's why they had 18-hour days." The Marines also held exercises on tactics, including attacking and defending areas. While they were not part of the formal training, Carey mentioned the value of having World War II veterans on hand during training. In his interview for an oral history with Dr. Laura Calkins of Texas Tech University in Lubbock, Carey said, "Those vets lived through it, World War II. They provided tips that you don't get out of a book." Later, he explained that it was best to learn from the experience of the guy who had been there before. He called the insight of the World War II Marines invaluable. Based on their experience in World War II Pacific battles, the vets emphasized the need to react and adjust to circumstances on the spot. General Carey acknowledged that there was no cold weather training, although his unit received emphasis on the importance of cold weather gear. On August 4, 1950, the Marine Corps reactivated 3rd Battalion 1st Marines. Carey's platoon went from 1st Platoon Alpha Company 6th Marines to 1st Platoon George Company 3-1. Following training at Camp Pendleton, Carey moved south to San Diego to load the USNS Simon B. Buckner, the ship that would eventually take him to Korea. Marines and sailors worked together to load the vessel. Lieutenant Carey ensured the equipment was loaded correctly on the ship. In June 1950, North Korea attacked South Korea in an attempt to control the entire peninsula of Korea. Landing at Incheon would catch the North Koreans by surprise. The success of the Incheon landing resulted in the recapture of Seoul and drove the North Korean forces back to North Korea. From San Diego, the Buckner sailed to Yokosuka, Japan, where the Marines needed to pick up additional equipment for Korea. The trip took 7 days. Training continued at the Marine base at Camp Otsu, just south of Yokosuka. This time, Carey said that nighttime training was the focus. The Marines also trained on conditioning, hiking, scouting, patrolling, and company field problem-solving activities. In addition, they rehearsed for the landing at Incheon. Again, Carey had the task of loading the Buckner. The loading process, known as combat loading, put the equipment needed first in Korea at the front of the deck. That equipment went on the ship last. Lesser priority items had to go in the back and came off the ship last. Logistics training at the basic school now had a practical application for the young lieutenant. Before Lieutenant Carey and his team could begin loading, a typhoon delayed the start of the process from September 5th to September 7th. Lack of motor transportation caused further delays in loading. At the port in Yokosuka, about an hour south of Tokyo, Lieutenant Carey put paper templates on the floor of the ship's deck to show the correct placement of each piece of equipment. While on his knees putting the templates down, the young officer met the most decorated Marine in the Corps' history with 5 Navy Crosses, the nation's second highest award for heroism in combat, Colonel Lewis B. Chesty Puller. He felt a tap on the shoulder and said, "Just a minute."
"What the hell do you think you're doing, Lieutenant?" hollered the colonel.
Carey explained that he was setting up the equipment placement. Colonel Puller told him to
throw away the blanking paper dolls and you'd get it done.
Puller retired as a lieutenant general. Carey described Puller as something else. He added that Puller connected well with the troops and described Puller in Korea as someone who reacted to the situation. He also added that Puller did not respect the Chinese capabilities. While Carey and his fellow Marines trained in Japan, the 1st Marine Brigade had quickly pushed into the Pusan perimeter at the southern tip of Korea on August 17, 1950, stopping the North Korean army from driving Allied troops out of Korea. That earned the brigade's nickname of Fire Brigade. On September 10th, the Buckner left Yokosuka and headed to port at Incheon, South Korea. One day away from Incheon, another typhoon hit. Waves estimated to be more than 50 feet high pounded the ship, but the Buckner weathered the storm and the next day reached its destination. A Marine Corps Special Action report after the war pointed out that the port was not ideal. The report concluded, "Nature and man contributed little toward making Incheon a good port to mount out of. There were no dock facilities and no nearby open areas for staging vehicles." The general pointed out that in his view, the North Koreans did not expect U.S. forces to land there due to high tides. As a result, General Carey said, the North Koreans did not protect the port at Incheon. It was a surprise. Most importantly, the landing at Incheon worked. One thing that the Marines knew, if they attempted to land earlier than 5:40 p.m. on September 15, 1915, they would be bogged down in mud. Since Carey's ship arrived early in the afternoon, his platoon held a debarkation exercise. Before leaving Japan, the Marines had loaded a pallet of 2x4 boards on the ship, according to then Private First Class Barb Harbula, a machine gunner who served with Carey as part of George Company, 3rd Battalion, 1st Marines, 3-1. The boards would form ladders to aid the Marines, as they had to climb a seawall once they arrived at Incheon. The Marines who landed at Incheon were loaded down like pack mules with supplies and ammunition. One private said that he carried a special pack that held 4 cans of ammunition instead of 2 cans. Each can weighed 18 pounds. As he looked back on the first moments after he and his platoon landed in Korea, Carey explained they soon took enemy fire. The platoon went directly to the beach away from the seawall. Other units used the makeshift ladders. The general talked about confusion and smoke on the beach. General Carey said the confusion came from the noise. Smoke came from burning buildings, and what he called combat smoke resulted from bombs and the firing of weapons. Due to those factors, Carey's platoon, 1st Platoon G George Company, 3rd Battalion 1st Marines, 3-1, ended up in a creek bed around which the North Koreans had placed concertina wire, also known as barbed or razor wire. Members of his platoon with wire cutters began cutting through the obstacle. Not everyone carried wire cutters, Carey explained. There were not enough cutters to go around, and even Carey did not have any. A member of his platoon standing next to Carey began cutting through the wire. The general recounted, "He took a round in the forehead. I grabbed his wire cutters and started cutting myself through the wire." The general said of that day, "God was watching out for me." A deeply religious man, General Carey acknowledged that during combat, he felt the hand of God. For the 22-year-old second lieutenant, that was the first of 7 narrow escapes from death during his 189 days in Korea. Already, within hours of reaching Korea, Carey had to handle the death of a member of his platoon. "You can never be trained to know that. It startles you. No way to be prepared. You try to imagine that it will happen and you do your best with it." The general explained TBS covered that situation during operational training. Although a fellow Marine had lost his life, Carey said that he had to take care of the mission right now, accomplish what you're supposed to accomplish. His platoon made it out of the creek bed and moved on to their next objective, Radio Hill. They began receiving enemy shell fire. A bullet shot Carey's radio off his shoulder. That was the second near miss for the lieutenant during his first hours in Korea. 2 more members of his platoon died. Then Carey learned the shelling had come from the U.S. Navy. In retrospect, Carey said, "Well, I was a little perturbed, but that's war." By evening, Carey's platoon held Radio Hill, and he received a replacement radio. During the first hours after the landing, the 3rd Battalion suffered 19 casualties. 4 men, including the 3 from Carey's platoon, died, and 15 were wounded. The next day, Carey's unit headed for Seoul. They made the 20-mile trek on foot. Even in the first days in Korea, senior Marines put Carey in a leadership role. Carey described his early assignment when he said, "My platoon was sent forward again. I don't know what it was, but I was always kind of the chosen one." When asked to assess, from his perch as a 3-star general, why Lieutenant Carey went out as the point, he said, "Leadership picked me to do the hard things. I proved myself in battle in the beginning. I gained the hill, Radio Hill, before it was expected. The goal was to get there as fast as possible and save as many guys as possible." Private First Class Bob Harbula, who served as a machine gunner with Lieutenant Carey as a member of George Company, described Lieutenant Carey as an upfront leader who was trusted by the men. Positive response to the Inchon landing came within the military and from the media. Navy Lieutenant Joseph Wright said this about the first Mardiv's landing on Inchon: "I've never seen such courage." Lieutenant Wright, a 14-year veteran of the Navy, served in the Pacific during World War II. His ship, the USS Whiteside, helped bring equipment for use by the Marines from Japan. New York Times military analyst Hanson Baldwin said the tides at Inchon were right. Baldwin, a Pulitzer Prize recipient, graduated from the United States Naval Academy. At the time of the landing, the North Koreans had not heavily mined the harbor. Baldwin praised General Douglas MacArthur when he wrote, "The Inchon landing of September 15th was a great gamble, and General MacArthur deserved major credit for its success." The Marines, including Lieutenant Carey, landed at Inchon at 5:30 p.m. Korean time. Within 30 minutes of landing, they were 2 miles into the city of Inchon. 2 hours later, they were pushing toward Seoul. According to the Salt Lake City Tribune, on October 26, 1950, the 1st Marine Division landing at Inchon turned the tide of the war. An editorial in the Charlotte News described the Inchon landings this way: "Then came the Inchon landings, and the Korean War did an about-face. Defeat swiftly turned into victory, a brilliant and impressive victory that removed many of the bitter memories of those grim first weeks." General MacArthur pledged that the Inchon invasion will end the war in Korea by winter and save 100,000 lives. That statement turned out to be inaccurate by nearly 3 years. On Carey's second day in Korea, while on the road to Seoul, his platoon encountered a platoon of 20 North Korean soldiers. Carey spotted the enemy's platoon leader. He pulled out his .45 caliber pistol. His North Korean counterpart surrendered. Due to the actions of Lieutenant Carey's platoon, 5 North Koreans died and 15 became war prisoners of the Americans. A Marine intelligence team quickly interrogated the captives because of their shock of being taken prisoner, Carey said. That brief exchange with the North Koreans formed Carey's opinion of the enemy soldiers. He said they were not seasoned soldiers, and in his view, they lacked the will to fight. For leading the capture of 15 POWs on his second day in Korea, the Marine Corps awarded Carey the Bronze Star Medal for Valor. Shortly after that, Colonel Puller and Lieutenant Carey would meet again at an award ceremony. As it turned out, General Carey explained, he ended up being the lone officer receiving an award that day. Puller, once an enlisted man who, according to Carey, did not necessarily like officers, said, "What the hell are you doing here?" The lieutenant replied that he was there for an award. Later, Colonel Puller asked Carey if he was the lieutenant loading the ship up in Japan. "Yes, sir," Carey replied. The colonel had remembered the young officer. General Carey said that Colonel Puller talked separately with each Marine who received an award that day and taught him that no problem was ever too big. According to Colonel Puller, problem-solving required two things: strong decisions and dedication. At 10 a.m. on September 17, 1950, George Company, including Carey's platoon, moved toward Seoul. The next day, George and item companies from 3-1 took Hill 123. Numbers assigned to a hill equaled the height of the hill in meters above sea level, despite undergoing heavy mortar fire. On his third day in Korea, Carey's 1st platoon rendezvoused with the battalion. Again, Carey took point. He rode with a unit of tanks and sat on one of the tanks. Speaking about this experience, Carey said that he spotted a North Korean T-34 tank sticking out of the window of a roadside building. He yelled, "Tank!" to the commander. The tank commander fired and took out the tank, but the movement knocked Carey off the tank and onto the ground. After that, the platoon spotted a North Korean motorcycle with an officer riding in the sidecar. Several members of the platoon fired and killed the North Koreans. Carey's unit continued down the road. As they approached a hill, the North Koreans began firing at Carey's platoon. The lieutenant had gathered his platoon behind a building to develop a plan to stop the North Koreans when one of his men pointed to the road. Walking down the middle of the road was none other than the commander of the United Nations forces, 5-star General MacArthur. Carey said MacArthur was dressed in his khaki-colored uniform, wore his sunglasses, and carried his trademark corncob pipe. North Koreans continued firing. Carey leaped up, grabbed MacArthur, and pulled him to the ground behind a building.
"What the hell do you think you're doing, Lieutenant?" yelled the man who outranked Carey by 11 steps.
Lieutenant Carey told General MacArthur that he was trying to keep him alive. General MacArthur told him,
"Lieutenant, the bullet isn't made that can kill me."
Seeing MacArthur on the line bolstered my confidence, the general said. In hindsight, General Carey saw the move as an unnecessary risk.
That was why I pulled him down.
In a June 2021 email, staff members at the MacArthur Memorial in Norfolk, Virginia, said that there was a vague recollection of a story about something like this happening to MacArthur in Korea, but no hard evidence or documentation. MacArthur did ask what Carey had planned to do about the enemy action he faced. Lieutenant Carey briefed the general on his next steps, and MacArthur told him that sounded like a good plan. Carey's platoon fought its way through another 10 miles to Seoul. By September 21st, 3-1 reached the highway toward Seoul and inflicted heavy casualties on the North Koreans. The Marines killed an estimated 200 enemy soldiers and captured 25 POWs. There, Carey saw General MacArthur for the second time. MacArthur called the 22-year-old junior officer to his jeep and asked him,
"Throw down any generals lately?"
He added, "Keep up the good work." 71 years after his two brief meetings with General MacArthur, General Carey made a few observations about the man who became a brigadier general during World War I and had the word general in his title for 33 years. "MacArthur thought he was a god," said General Carey. He described MacArthur as someone who thought he did not make mistakes and did everything right. He added that MacArthur was in love with himself and overconfident. Carey's unit pushed forward to Yeongdong-po, arriving at the Han River just outside of Seoul. At Yeongdong-po, the North Koreans offered heavy resistance as they defended Seoul. Lieutenant Carey put his platoon sergeant, Staff Sergeant Gerald Tillman, in for a Silver Star for his actions that day. In the write-up that generated the medal, Lieutenant Carey described the sergeant's exceptional leadership and the fact that he put himself at more risk than he had to for his platoon. Carey shared his thoughts about the medals process during an interview for the Texas Tech Oral History Project.
"The Marines are pretty tough on that. They are tougher than the Army is. I don't say that maliciously. It's just a fact."
He later added, "You don't get medals handed out in the Marine Corps. You've got to earn them." George Company, including Lieutenant Carey's platoon, took the lead into Seoul after crossing over the Han River on September 25th in a landing vehicle tracked, LVT. The LVTs permitted amphibious travel over water. Once in Seoul, the Marines faced enemy fire from the North Koreans that included snipers. They met additional resistance coming from North Koreans in a school building. Carey took his troops to the hills located behind the school, he said. The unit faced what General Carey described as intense fire. The gunnery sergeant in his company took a hit to the stomach. Carey carried the much larger Marine about 200 yards to the command post, which had a battalion aid station located nearby. There, a fellow Marine noticed Carey's blood-covered uniform. He asked Lieutenant Carey if he had also been wounded. Carey explained that the blood came from the gunnery sergeant's wound and that he would return to the line after bringing the wounded man in for treatment. That night, the North Koreans counterattacked with tanks and infantry. The Marines battled back and took out four enemy tanks. Positioned near one of his unit's tanks, Carey suffered a ruptured eardrum from the noise. By 2005, General Carey said, he had a 90% hearing loss in that ear. Sent back to the rear, Carey and his platoon had 2 days of rest. That rest period did not include hot meals nor a shower, but he had time to write family members. While in Seoul, Carey and a wounded sergeant, 23-year-old Gene F. Lilly from Oklahoma, briefly rested on a curb as they waited for a corpsman. A bullet went between the two. Carey and Lilly stood up to move away, but as the pair stood up, a bullet struck and killed Sergeant Lilly. That was another near miss for Carey. Just 10 days after arriving at Inchon, Carey's platoon reached Seoul. On September 28th, the battalion received orders to protect the route into Seoul for General MacArthur's re-entry into the city. The entire battalion guarded Seoul's Po Boulevard for MacArthur and the United Nations Group. George Company guarded the Presidential Palace grounds. After that, Carey's platoon spent a night in South Korean President Syngman Rhee's Presidential Palace. President Rhee was not home that night. The general said, "The way it happened, we were in a fight and needed to rest in a secure place." He did acknowledge that he took it upon himself to go there. General Carey described the evening at the place as peaceful and comfortable. Seoul. Carey's platoon drove forward through Seoul to cross the 38th parallel. They faced, he said, only sporadic resistance from the North Korean soldiers. While battlefield casualties and the loss of friends and fellow Marines had an impact on the young officer, civilian deaths were even more upsetting to Carey. Just north of Seoul, the platoon came upon bodies of women and children. According to the general, the communist forces had massacred them. All of the victims suffered gunshot wounds to the back of the head. After crossing the 38th parallel, the platoon received orders to return to Inchon. This time, they made the trip in trucks instead of on foot. By then, the one-time 165-pound high school wrestler's weight had dropped to about 130 pounds. Carey described his platoon as dirty, tired, and worn out. The Army's 1st Cavalry Division replaced the Marines. While the Marines rode packed onto trucks, the soldiers traveled in two-man jeeps. To add insult to injury, one soldier yelled out, "Oh, it's the raggedy-ass Marines!" A member of Carey's platoon took offense to that soldier's comment. He tossed a grenade at the soldier. Although Carey's troop did not pull the pin on the grenade, the loudmouthed soldier dove into the water. There were no other disparaging comments directed at the Marines. General Carey admitted that he thought he knew who threw the grenade, but said that he was not sure. A look back. In the after-action report, signed by Carey's battalion commander, Lieutenant Colonel Thomas L. Ridge, conclusions included the following.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.